Hey, everybody. Hope you are doing well. I think I want to listen to one of the prettiest voices I've ever heard. Alison Krauss's voice to me is the voice of an angel. It's just so beautiful. And the fact that she is the guidestone for an entire genre of music, the entire bluegrass genre, pretty much has been following Alison Krauss and Alison Krauss and Union Station's lead for two decades now, maybe a little longer than that, is incredible. It doesn't get talked about very much because, you know, it's not exactly a mainstream art form, the bluegrass arts. But she is incredibly important in that particular vein of country and folk music. She is one of the top Grammy Award-winning artists of all time. I mean, basically, your top three in no particular order are Alison Krauss and Union Station, Quincy Jones, and Beyoncé. And yes, I know Beyoncé has more Grammys than any other artist in history. But again, as I've said it in previous videos, who did she pass to get there? And given the fact that, in my opinion, the Grammy Awards are a industry popularity contest and really don't have a lot to do with actual musicianship and creativity. They have to do with album sales, especially in the last 5 to 10 years. It's shifted that way, much the same way that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame doesn't induct rock artists. It inducts popular artists. And hence the reason why bands like Kansas and Jethro Tull aren't in, yet Dolly Parton and LL Cool J and Donna Summer are in. You got to look at anything that is connected to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Rolling Stone magazine, and corporate awards as sort of tainted towards corporate messaging. With that said, Alison Krauss has, she's somewhere around 29 or 30 Grammy Awards. I mean, I think she won 5 for her work with Robert Plant on the album Raising Sand. I mean, again, tremendously influential, tremendously important in the music world. And let's do the song Lie Awake off of the Paper Airplanes album.
Thank you.
The way that Alison, her voice, the way Alison's voice and Dan Teminsky's voice harmonize is just perfect. The use of a mandolin, the use of a mandolin, I believe being played by Dan Teminsky, as almost a rhythm instrument in the sense that it's kind of sort of keeping the tempo of the song, especially in kind of almost like a hi-hat or ride cymbal type of fashion, is that kind of sound. I mean, he's playing chords, he's playing other stuff, but it's got a rhythmic sense to it, which in bluegrass, often some of the instruments like mandolin and banjo will be used rhythmically as much as melodically to create almost a drum pattern when there is no drum. Barry Bell's bass playing on it is absolutely wonderful. And I wonder how much of the orchestral string sounds in the background would have been played by him bowing his upright bass to correspond with his fingered upright bass. Most of the bass line itself is actually fingered upright bass, but with those string pads in the background, those string layers in the background, I wonder if he is actually playing any of them or if they brought in a string section to actually do the recording. I would have to look into the liner notes and what have you, but not going to bother doing that right now. Jerry Douglas's resonator work is absolutely gorgeous. And I love the fact that it's not overpowering the song, because I think this song didn't require that. I think it was nice that his fills were subtle and just they filled in gaps during the non-vocal section. That was absolutely, absolutely fantastic too. And then, of course, Ron Block on the acoustic guitar and the third harmony in the backing vocals. Just, again, this group is a group of all-stars within their genre and at their instruments. And it is, again, in that genre, it's pretty much the perfect group, at least in my opinion. With that said, thanks for watching. I appreciate you all. Please feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below, and we can talk about it further if you'd like. I wish you all well. Take care.